Okay, so we are live. Well, for the very early subscribers who are coming in, welcome. I was going to take a few minutes for everyone to join. So in the meantime, let me maybe just introduce myself. So welcome for this, like it's the fourth episode of this webinar series that we started back in March of this year. We are always focusing on different aspects of the energy policy, trying to get a more holistic approach, trying to understand a little better what everything that gets into play when designing energy policies. I am Paul. I have been working with YE since February and leading this Empower project on energy, trying to empower young people on the topic of energy and energy transition. Specifically, we are creating kind of a bank of knowledge for young people who'd be interested in this topic and would want to understand more and have kind of an in-depth understanding of everything that turns around the energy subtopic. I'm going to pause here for a second. We're going to take a few minutes to wait for other people to join, and then we'll get going. All right, so it's 34, close to 35. I think this is a good time to start. For those who are just joining us, welcome again. Today, we're going to be talking about influencing European energy policies. As I was saying briefly before, this is going to be the fourth episode of a webinar series around energy and understanding everything that comes into play when designing energy policies. And this topic was quite dear to my heart because I'm myself very interested in understanding what goes behind the scenes and what is involved and all the mechanics and the relation and the negotiations that are happening without us really knowing. And that ends up actually affecting us directly because the piece of legislation that are being passed and are being voted for ultimately impact our everyday life. And so I'm very happy to be joined today by two very experienced people in this matter. Maybe we will start, Monica, I'll let you introduce yourself and then Marina. What I would like to ask you is maybe who you are, if you can talk about the organization that you work for and give us kind of an overview of your field of expertise.
Okay, so I can start. Hello, everybody. Thank you, Paul, for inviting me to be here with you. I'm Monica Vidal. I'm the heating campaign coordinator at CAN Europe. that I joined at Can Europe like 2 years ago. And I dedicated to driving the decarbonization of buildings and heating system, and also promoting the sustainable renewable heating solution at a Euro level. So as I said, I started Can Europe like 2 years ago, and with the idea to promote this this campaign in relation with buildings and heating decarbonization. But previously, I was part of the national organization ECODES, Fundación Ecologistas de Desarrollo, where I have been working for 12 years, and we're actively engaged in the monitoring of climate and energy policies, both at European but also national level. And also, I had the honor to work with Marina also, that she's here today with us.
So thank you, and it's a pleasure to be here with you, and it's a pleasure to share this space with Monica. I'm Marina Gros. I'm an activist from Ecologistas en Acción. We are a national grassroots organization. We are more than 300 local groups all around the territory of Spain that we are working jointly, you know, like the local groups, aggregate in the federations and then in the confederation. So I'm working in the confederal, in the stated view, the national level, and I'm working for the gas campaign. I'm specialized in fossil gas and infrastructure, and in biogas and methane, and also in hydrogen. So it's like the focus of my work. But I started to work with Monica in ECODES some years ago. I have to say that I'm 27 years old, and I started to work on this field, this super tough field, when I was 22. But it has been super interesting and super, you know, like fills you when you understand more about all of these things about energy and how it works, because it affects us in our daily life. So being able to work on this and being able to, you know, to transform the work the world we are in this special movement that is super needed is super, super interesting. And also, I am an activist person and musician, so I'm always trying to merge this advocacy and super tough regulations we are working on with kind of art and kind of music and, you know, like more creative spaces that are also super interesting to, you know, to go to the general public and the people and the youth. So I hope we have a super nice conversation today. I'm super happy to be here.
It must have been very interesting for you, especially working on like gas for such a long time. Eventually the Ukraine crisis makes like put gas at the center of the map and everyone's talking about it. So even if it's kind of a tragic, it's a good news for you because your expertise is really on the spot and in the middle of everyone's attention. Right, so we're going to start with general questions. The point of this webinar is twofold. The first idea is, since you've been kind of working for quite a while in the influence of legislation making, I wanted to ask you some questions that are related to how this works. And then the second part, we're going to focus more on energy, talking about the campaign that Monica, you're leading, and Marina, your core activity within Spain, and see how this all articulates. So to kick things off, I think the first question I kind of wanted to ask you is, how exactly would you qualify or describe your activity in relations to European legislation? So that's for you, Monica. And then, since you've done both, it's a question for both of you, if you could try to pinpoint some of the main differences of like working at the EU level and working at the national level.
Okay, so maybe I can start and then I can give the floor to Marina. So that's just to start to explain you, at Can Europe, we are a network of NGOs. So that we work at EU level, but also in relation with other nodes that we have around the world. So so we coordinate also with other nodes in Africa and in the US, in Asia, et cetera, et cetera. So first, what we do at Can Europe is to promote sustainable climate, energy and development policies through Europe, but as I said, in coordination with the other nodes that we have, because we work also a lot on at international level, following the international negotiations. And at Can Europe, at EU level, we work with our members to achieve this goal through joint actions, information exchange, and coordinating the development of NGO strategy on international, as I said, but also regional and national climate issues. And basically, what you can say that we do is we monitor the different policies at EU level. In my case, in relation with energy-related policies, and nowadays very, very focused on buildings and heating. And so we identify which are the most important policies to make the impact now and fighting dangerous climate change. And together with our members, they help us also to prioritize and to also to decide, okay, now we should focus on this now. There, maybe later we can focus on the solar issues. And the idea is that normally what we are asking and what we are doing is to try to have a more ambition legislation in general. And also sometimes what we try to do is to remove the part that we don't like in the current negotiations, and just to try to contribute to the overall decarbonization objective. And about the differences with the work at national level, what I want to say is at EU level, we follow this in the negotiation at EU level, but at national level, you need to keep an eye what is happening at EU level, but also what is happening at national level, because your work mostly is like, okay, maybe trying to influence what is happening at national level, but you need to understand what is happening at EU level. So I understand that the work at national level is even more complicated sometimes. Sometimes I feel sorry for our members at national level, because we ask you a lot of things. And, I know that you are very, very busy, but I will give the floor to Marina to compliment about this part.
So I have to say that Ecologistas is part of the Can Europe, and it's super interesting when you are new in a topic, you just go to the Can Europe expert and they explain to you what is happening with this new EU regulation. And then, as Monica said, it's super different with the things you have to do at national level. One thing is because people, general public, citizens, doesn't care about what is happening in Europe, but they care about what is happening in the national context. So you have to translate all of this, and you have to adapt the angles, also talking with the politicians and the decision makers. You have to adapt everything you are doing to the national context and how it will help to the citizens and everyone. So I would say that's the main different thing. Also that the actors are different, it's not the same. For example, one of our activities is talking with the national European members of the parliament, the MEPs. We, for example, I speak with the Spanish ones, because you are in some way trying to translate and to transmit to them what is the opinion of the civil society in Spain. So with them, you can talk in European language and with the file, because they are so into the topic. But it's different when you want to talk with, for example, the government or the people from the Spanish parliament. So you have to explain them a lot of things, or you have to translate it a lot. So you have to go from a more national perspective, and you have to understand well who is the implications between the European files and the national files. Because usually when you have these European files approved, they just go as the same into the national context. So you have to tell them, like, yeah, if you change something in Europe, then we'll be able to change, it will be translated like this in the national one. So yeah, you have to work with all of these elements, and everything is, you try to do whatever in all the different spaces you have, just to push for a for a more ambitious legislation. But in this work, it's super useful to have these Can Europe coordinators, people that are really into following the regulations, because if not, you are completely lost. You have a lot to do, a lot of things at the same time. But yeah, this kind of team between the different national organizations, you can learn also for the things that the other organizations are doing in their countries. And this is super helpful because they just give another perspective and another ideas that you can tackle and see if it's going to work in your country. Yeah.
If I may, Paul, I just wanted to highlight what Marina mentioned about the how difficult it is to communicate about EU policies at national level, because one part of our job is okay just to talk with policymakers, but also to communicate a lot to the public audience about the different topics that we are working on. And at EU level is much more easy. There is a lot of media outlet that talk about the EU processes, but at national level is very complicated. So it's really a very hard work to adapt it, to try to do it in a very appealing way that they communicated about at national level. And normally, but how they communicate in the media outlets, in the national media outlets, is about, okay, Europe decide this, so that will affect me in that way. But we need to turn a little bit the discourse, like, okay, what you decide and what you're saying and how you vote in Europe will affect Spanish citizens, Bulgarian citizens. So that's part of the job also at national level.
Yeah, that's it's crazy. I have the thing, I've heard this ever since I started to get interested in the European Union, which is almost like 15 years ago, and we still haven't managed to bridge that gap. And it is the core of the 2024 European parliamentary elections. I was in a meeting, and literally what we were saying is like, okay, clearly we're not managing to talk to citizens, especially about environmental issues. So how do we get to them and how do we talk to them? And I guess, yes, in this matter, this is where like the national organizations play a big role in sort of like explaining what European work does and how it influences people's life. But one question that I have is like, so far what we've said is that you have the European level organization that is using the national level to get more local establishment understanding. But can it be sometimes the other way around? Like, do you sometimes, Marina, have direct access to MEPs or they come to consult you directly?
Yes, for example, when you start to establish a relationship with a way of communication with the different MEPs, could be the possibility that they identify you as one of the experts for this. Because you have to understand that MEP is a person with a team, but they are overwhelmed about all the work they are doing. So sometimes you are like more like the technical advisor also to them, so you can provide them with good information, with opportunities. And it's still a time when they start to call you like, what do you think about this? You read what was the last resolution? What do you think about this article? We keep it like this or not? So it's super, super interesting when you start to have these deep conversations about the legislation, because then you feel like, yeah, they are taking into account the voices of the society from Spain. So yeah, it's a super good moment.
Okay, thank you. So another question that comes to mind when I hear you speaking is that obviously you're not the only one who are trying to push for a certain agenda, and there are loads of different opinions, and MEPs are being confronted to, MEPs and National Member of Parliament, are being confronted to this opinion. So you basically in your work have to meet with a lot of stakeholders who are trying to push for their own agenda. Can I ask you to have an idea, what is your relationship with them and what's the main difference maybe in the approach or in the action that they are leading?
Okay, I can start if you want, Marina. In this work, sometimes there are different NGOs working in the same issue as you. So let's start with the NGOs. So the idea first with different NGOs is to coordinate as much as possible if you are defending the same messages, the same policy demands. So the idea is to coordinate and look for joint actions to help that the message is here louder and clear. So that will be my first point. So the collaboration with the different NGOs and think tanks. And then we have some cases where in working in different issues that there are not many NGOs working on that. That happened a lot, especially in a very technical legislations that Marina knows about it. So sometimes we need to team up with some other kind of stakeholders and sometimes private sectors that are in line with your messages. But of course, that needs to be decided and analyzed case by case, because, for example, you can be aligned in one of the points, but not in the whole legislation or not in the whole view about other legislation that you are working on. So it's very complicated. And this is something that you need to analyze case by case, as I said. And then you have the other forces, for example, sectors associated with fossil fuels, companies, etc. So in that case, that they go in an opposite direction to what you defend. And basically, what we do as Can Europe, for example, is, and it's one most part of our job, is try to counter argument their messages. That's what we need to do. And for that, we produce a lot of reports showing, exposing data and mythbusters in relation to what they are saying, and naming and shaming sometimes, and as clearly as possible. And so the idea is that these messages also reach to policymakers and mainly other stakeholders that could be joined forces with you in the future.
Okay. To complement Monica, from a national perspective and my sector, that I am working on gas, and we are, I'm coordinating a network that is called Gas is Not a Solution. We are more than 20 NGOs, and it has been like a super tough work starting working together, having common objectives, to align all of our proposals. But nowadays we are working very well because we are few in Spain working on several topics. So we need to be united, and then we will have more strong on this. And especially on the part of what happened with these lobbyists, the ones coming from the fossil fuel industry. We do from Ecologistas en Acción, especially, we do a lot of naming and shaming. It's one of our favorite actions to do. For example, with this with the system operator of the gas system in Spain, that is called Enagas, we produce a report about all of these revolving doors they have, where they are taking the money, what they are doing with the money, how much they are meeting with the government, how much they are meeting with the European Commission, with the Parliament, etc. So showing up all the access that these guys have to the political makers. So I believe this is super useful. There is an organization in Europe that is called CEO. That is doing this very well. So, and they have a campaign that is keep polluters from politics or something like this. I just give to you the possibility to look for it, because it's very interesting. And we need to do more, because we have to be clear that if the, for example, they usually you have this example with the tobacco. You don't allow the tobacco industry to go to a medicine and health congress, to explain them how to put them the laws against tobacco. what we are doing this with the fossil fuel industry, what we are allowing them to go to the meetings, to go to present reports, to allow them to have any kind of legitimacy to be there. So I have to be very, I want to be very clear with this, like, we have to denounce this situation, and that's why we do a lot of naming and shaming with this.
And does that mean, from what you're saying, that you have the feeling that maybe this, like, lobbyist or like a representative of fossil fuel industries have more of a direct access to politicians and decision makers, and it's more difficult for NGOs to get the same kind of relations? Is it what you're saying?
Yeah, oh, that obviously, and they have, first, they have much more resources, that's the main point. So they have resources, they have money, so they have a lot of people working on that, and that's a scale to all the connections and everything. Yeah, but maybe Marina, you want to complement?
Yeah, you can see in the different reports, you can see how much meetings they have in comparison with the meetings we have and the difficulties we have for, you know, for asking, especially with the policymakers that are more in the right wing parties. Yes. Yeah, so yeah, we maybe have more access to the Greens or the left, for example, in the European Parliament. But if you go to the Renew or EPP, kind of bit more difficult. So yeah, especially in this part.
Okay, so that's actually kind of leads me to the next question that I wanted to ask you is, so since the point of this webinar is to try to get an idea of how things go beyond the scene, when it comes for a policy to be drafted and eventually come into an actual law, what are the main stakeholders that are taking place in the whole drafting of the proposal, negotiations, and then eventually the influence and so throughout the whole process? What would you say are the main most important people? Where does the experience and the expertise come from? And are you generally part of it?
Well, maybe we can start with the who decides, no? Because in the EU processes, let's say we have three different organisms. We have the European Commission, we have the European Parliament, and we have the European Council. I think sometimes it's important to also understand the difference also between them, because in the European Parliament you have the people voted directly by the European citizens, and so that are the MEPs, the members of the European Parliament, and then they may join the political group that they are more in line with their political affinities. But then in the European Council you have representation from the national governments. So in the national government can be from the party that the government is in the government in that moment, and also in the council we have the presidency that is rotating like every six months. And now, for example, during these 6 months, from June until the end of the year, is the Spanish presidency. So it's Spain who is president in the European Council, and that affects the way how the negotiations go, because they prioritize different files. So it's important to understand this by basic points in the EU processes, the different organisms, and also because so when you are planning your activities to influence any legislation, first you need to understand in which moment we are, because sometimes it could be that okay, that this legislation is in the council or is in the parliament, so depending where it is you need to influence the MEPs or the council. So that's clear. But then at the end, there is the trilogues normally that depends also on the legislation. But most part of the times there is a trilogue. So that's a conversation between the three organisms, the Commission, the European Parliament, and the Council. And then in that moment, you need to talk with everybody at the same time. And it's very complicated and quite crazy. And so we are in that moment right now with the EPPD, the European Performance Efficient for the Directive for Buildings. We are in this right moment. For example, the 12th of December is the third trialogue. So we are in exactly this moment with the Spanish presidency. So Spain, for example, is one of the key countries. And for example, most part of the activities that we are planning or implementing are very focused with Spain because have a lot of influences in what is happening, because they can prioritize the finalization of this directive or deprioritize it.
Yeah, to complement Monica, I remember the first time she explained it to me some years ago. but I will say that, for example, I identify some people in the European Parliament that are more accessible and also that can give you more security to be involved with, especially from a youth perspective, that are the assistants of the MEPs. You know, like assistants are usually the ones that are more involved into the legislation and they know more. So maybe it's a way to have more time to discuss some of the topics, and they are more keen to have more a meeting with you. So they're super nice persons usually, very talkative and very keen to listen to you. And actually there is another stakeholder that are the advisors for the different political groups. So yeah, having a good relationship with advisors, following the same regulation you are into, is always a good thing to do. The difficulty is to find them. But then you have to be, you know, like a researcher and try to find the right person. And also, if you have a good relationship with an assistant, you can ask, hey, who from this party, who would you recommend me to call, and with people you are you talking, and so on. So maybe they are keen to say to you, yeah, which person could be interesting to us for a meeting and so on. And actually, to complement also on this part of the presidency of the council, we know that nowadays Spain has the presidency, and this gives the power, as Monica explained it, to prioritize or deprioritize some of the files. But for example, they are less vocal in the files because they have to be more neutral. You know, like they need to coordinate all of the parties, so they cannot be so vocal and they can be so strong with their position. So in some way, this is good because help us to, you know, like pushing for something. But at the same time, it's like Spain is supposed to have quite a weight in the decisions of the council. So don't having them to have a strong positions, for example, in something related to the production of hydrogen coming from nuclear electricity, for example, that Spain is super against of nuclear hydrogen. Don't having them like super strong with this position is kind of, we can miss the opportunity, but you know, like always is a balance of opportunities and possibilities.
So when it comes to presidency of the European Union, basically it's better to intervene before in order to help drafting the guidelines. But then once the presidency is there, then you kind of have to wait and see. Okay, so but this was more, I think, like you were talking about more the parliamentary issue or like a sector, I would say. What if we're trying to get ahead of ourselves and talk about the European Commission? Because the European Commission at the EU level is the institution that is in charge of the legislative initiative. It's the one that's starting the projects. Is there any way for national and European level NGOs to have some kind of influence on what is the priority that the European Commission is going to choose, what reform is going to be led, etc.? Monica, maybe if you want to start.
I can start. And if from my perspective, this is one of the main the main difference between the work we do at national level, at the European level. I think at EU level, for example, the work that Can Europe is more in contact with the Commission, for example, and than for example, national NGOs. That's, for example, that I see that's a big difference for me since I've been working at national level and I'm working now at EU level. So I understand, for example, that's why it's important for national organizations be part of this kind of umbrella organization, umbrella network organizations, as Can Europe, EEB, ECOS, many of them, and because like that they will have the information from these meetings with the Commission, and also they can participate in joint actions, for example, joint letters that these umbrella organizations promote to influence the agenda of the Commission. And that's one point. And then of course the Commission sometimes they open public consultations and also they are open to everybody, including the national organizations. But anyway, it's also, I think, is one part of the role of these umbrellas NGOs also to communicate about these processes, just to remember what is happening. And I think it's a good moment for you to have a say about this. So yeah, I think that's what I wanted to say. Yeah,
we usually participate in these joint letters that are proposed by the umbrella organizations, and also these I have to say from the Commission that are quite interesting, but I don't know how much they read us, but we always do it. Yeah, sometimes it's just by the help of the Can Europe, for example. Other times, if it's something that we are more specialized, we make our own analysis and our own answer to this. But I wanted to talk you a little bit about a process that I've been, as an activist, I've been in this. It's about the public funds used for sustainable tourism in the Aragonese Pyrenees. So there is a project that was for building up a cable car from one ski resort to another ski resort. So it was destroying completely a natural valley, a bridging, and so on. So I and a bunch of activists from the local local groups there, we were to Brussels to talk with the European Commission. So we had a possibility to meet with the Tax for Recovery, that are the people that are looking and analyzing the results of the Next Generation Funds. And we were able also to talk with the people, the legal advisors for the DG environmental part of the Commission. So yeah, there are things you can do from the national perspective, but usually, you know, like they are super related to small projects or small things that are happening in your local background. Yeah, and also it's super helpful to have, you know, like people in Brussels, people like Monica or others, just to help you, you know, like when you are navigating in this complex space of the European Commission, just to select who is the person you need to talk with and so on. So it's very helpful having this exchange and constant work with the European organizations.
Okay, thank you very much. So since the time is passing, I think now it's time to actually go and talk a little bit more about energy, which is technically the core of this session. We'll start with you, Monica. One of the reasons we got in contact is because you're leading a campaign which is entitled Build Better Lives. I think it's a pretty good example of like an EU-wide campaign that's its purpose is to influence the drafting of a piece of legislation. So the purpose of this campaign is to sort of shape the reform of the Energy Performance Building Directive. So why is this such an important step, and can you tell us a bit about this campaign and how it works?
Yep. Yeah, the revision of the Energy Performance of Buildings Directive is a crucial starting point that can steer EU member states towards developing more supportive framework for holistic buildings renovation in our buildings. So combining the insulation of the buildings, but also the installation of renewable heating solution. So basically it's important because if this goes well, we will have more energy efficient buildings, and we will reduce the energy consumption of our buildings, and that will lower our energy bills along with greenhouse gas emissions. So that's the theory, and that's why it's important, and that we are asking for an ambitious and a socially just EPBD.
Okay, yeah, because from what I understand, buildings are actually a really important emitters of greenhouse gas emission. It's like 35 or 36% of the entire emissions of the European Union. Can you give us an idea of exactly what is it that you're advocating for? What are the reform or modification to the existing text that you wish to see implemented?
Well, there are many, and we are working in relation with many articles, but maybe what I can focus more in relation about the points and the articles in which we are highlighting within the campaign, with the Build Better Lives campaign, because in this campaign we are pushing for half a very ambitious minimum energy performance standards for our buildings, and also to phase out fossil fuels boilers in our buildings. That are the two of the main provisions where we are making more effort during with this campaign, and also highlighting the importance of social safeguards in the directive also, because this reform, we understand that these kind of reforms, we need to maximize the social benefits of the climate action, and that's just a climate action, and we need to maximize the social benefits. So, because we understand that everyone will be better on a climate resilient home, and that will have an impact, a significant impact on people's everyday life, transforming the places where we live, where we study, where we work. But also we need to protect vulnerables, and we need to be sure that we're going to have affordable and accessible and tailored funding to grant it really to cover the investment that they need. And for that, we need social safeguards to be sure that will happen.
Okay, so just to get an idea, because you mentioned several things. So you're talking about renewable heating systems. What is that? What are we talking about? What kind of technology does that entail?
Okay, I mentioned that one of the provinces where in which we are working is that you have a phase out of fossil fuels boilers in buildings, and so these fossil fuels buildings need to be substituted by other solutions, and this is what I meant for renewable heating solution. What we are talking about renewable heating solution, normally it's heat pumps that use renewable electricity or geothermal, or that are for example use other kind of renewable sources, like for example solar thermal also, and solar thermal panels could be also including in these renewable heating solutions, because that's when we are talking about heating, we are talking also to heat the water to have warm water at home. So that's what I mean by renewable heating solutions. Also, okay. District heating that use renewable sources, that could mm-hmm. be renewable heating solutions.
Okay, and one more thing you mentioned, you're saying that you're advocating for a minimum energy performance of the building. So, so far, the way it works is that every building is rated from F to A, A being the most insulated and the best graded. So the point is, you're by imposing mandatory insulation of the worst rated building, you're hoping to eliminate most of the Fs, which I think still represent quite a sizable amount of the buildings in the EU.
What we are guessing is that the buildings, building renovation really increase. That's what we are guessing, because also if we are talking about the letters, the different letters, that's it's very complicated, but also because it's also different between different countries. So because that's part of the implementation then later. So but what we are guessing when we are talking about ambitious MEPs, and because this it's also the acronym for minimum energy performance standards. What we are guessing is that we're gonna have more worst, especially the worst performing energy buildings renovated.
Okay. Right. So last question is regarding this campaign. Since we're talking about influencing and the police solicitation, what exactly is your strategy and how do you expect to actually get what you're looking for or aiming at?
Yeah, well, we at CAN Europe, but together with also Financial Theory at Europe, we put it together this campaign, the Build Better Life campaign, but with the idea to have an extra effort during the trialogues for the EPPD. So for during since May, in June until the end of the year, hopefully. And the idea is to organize a collective call to action and to have a stronger influence on EU decision makers, including also different member states, because we understand that it's very important to have a special effort at national level, at least in some key countries. So what we are doing, we drafted an open statement that so far has been signed by 79 organizations. And what we are doing is engaging and also mobilizing with EU national campaigns organization, but social movement also, young movements, for example, and grassroots movement, but also consumer organization, academia, trade unions, social organizations. The thing is that in this case, for the campaign, if we are talking about social safeguards, if we are talking about protecting vulnerables, we understood that we need to have the support from the social organizations. That's why we amplified the scope of our work, that because we are normally working with the environmental NGOs, and we opened the scope, and we are very happy to have on board organizations that have a lot of experience working with vulnerables. For example, like Fundación Abbé Pierre in France, Ecologistas in Spain, or for example, Caritas, Red Cross Europe, this kind of organization that really they are in contact with the people, and they know about what they are suffering, what they need.
Okay, and how is it going? Like, do you already have some kind of feedback from the institutional side? Do you feel like this campaign, because it's been pretty huge? I remember, like, on Twitter, you guys trended for a while, so it's really was a quite followed, this campaign. Do you start already to see some concrete outcomes?
Yes, well, the first outcome, I see that a lot of people is contacting us and proposing things. So now that's good. Actually, that's we need to understand that this is because the launch of the open statement was quite very success. But in the more in the political advocacy world, let's say, what we are seeing is that for example, the European Parliament, the rapporteur office, we are sharing with them these numbers to say, listen, if you are pushing for these social safeguards, if you are pushing for these MEPs, you have here the support of a lot of organizations from different angles, from different perspectives that really supports this. So that helped to really, that this this open statement and this campaign, the main idea is that the key messages are here very loud and loudly, and very clear and loudly, and that's what I think we are achieving this. And the campaign was covered in many European media outlets and also national media outlets. So I think let's see what's happening, but so far it's at least we can say that we are united and we are joining forces, and I think that's a good start.
Okay, well, really amazing work, and well, we hope that it will have the outcomes that you're expecting. Let's maybe now pivot more to the national level. So as you were saying at the beginning, Marina, your domain of expertise is gas, and you're working mostly on Spain. So can you give us like an idea of what are the most important topics that you're working on, and how exactly are you leading your campaigns to compare the national and the European level?
Okay, so what I have to say is that the war in Ukraine has just changed all the main arguments, the main perspective, the general ideas we have in the previous years. So this is what we call a shock doctrine. I don't know, maybe you know Naomi Klein that has elaborated this concept. So having this in mind, we just seen how the power, the government, the different energy industry just rebuild these projects of super enormous infrastructure for joining, for example, Spain to France, or these projects that were dead in the past, they just offer again, under the umbrella of this European solidarity and the security of Europe. So this is a super alarming narrative that we are facing, and it's also linked with the translation or the substitutions of from gas, fossil gas, to green hydrogen, and then also biogas or biomethane. So we are facing all of these narratives at the same time. So we are fighting against the new projects they want to build. We are facing the false solutions of the transition that are the green hydrogen and the biomethane. And we are seeing how this the Power EU objective that has increased a lot, the hydrogen production and biomethane production, is taken by the industries, the gas industry, just to greenwash and just to give them the free, like, no, you don't have to worry. We are going to build this infrastructure, but don't worry, because in the future it will be run 10% in hydrogen or in 100% in biomethane. So yeah, don't worry. Everything will be green in the future. But we know that is not true. So we are pushing so hard into stopping these false solutions, and to redirect all of these funds, the public funds, the private investment, into the projects and the solutions that are already there for helping the people, helping the society. And I wanted to show you an example of a campaign that I'm super proud, because we work together with my colleagues that are working in the taxonomy, also the people that are working in the energy charter treaty, that maybe you know that is also a file that maybe Spain and the European Commission is going to just go out from this energy treaty. So we started to analyze that all of this part just are working together. The energy treaty is protecting this investment in fossil fuels infrastructure and contracts and so on. And also the taxonomy is allowing the investors to invest in fossil fuels, in fossil gas, because they leave it as green. And also all of this situation regarding gas with the crisis coming from the war in Ukraine, but was coming from the past, from the recovery from COVID. It was also starting this energy crisis from there, not only from Ukraine. So we detected this puzzle, and we just merged our campaign together, and we make something that is representing the two souls of Ecologistas en Acción. That is, one is this advocacy work that we are doing, and the other part is that the activist one. So we write a letter for the deputies in the Parliament of Spain, and at the same time we have an action in the door of the Congress. There was I'm going to explain to you, because maybe the video that we are going to see is a bit confusing. So it was an enormous dinosaur making from different parts of fossil fuels, a plane, a pipeline, a well for extracting petroleum. So all of this, you know, like saying like, the fossil fuels are from the past, from the dinosaurs. So we don't know, we don't want them. And so we have this super bigger inflated dinosaur in the doors of the parliament, and we make a song with the lyrics talk about the gas, the taxonomy, the nuclear, and the energy charged TV, and we make a flash move at the same time. So this is something that is interesting, because you can join this advocacy and also this funny and more impressive to the media, because in this, with this video, we have a lot of attention with the media. The last part is like it was raining, so no, all the people come there. But you know, like at the least we have the video and we have the possibility. So I wanted to show you to you because I'm really proud of the work, the young work we made.
So we'll see if we can show the video in question. That would be very interesting to see.
Combustibles fósiles tiene que llegar a su fin. Cualquier desarrollo de infraestructuras de combustibles fósiles nos alejará de la última oportunidad de evitar el caos climático. Los tratados y el gas. No te quieres enterar. Los países que deciden adoptar medidas encaminadas a la descarbonización del sistema energético pueden ser objeto de demandas millonarias. Este tratado es un obstáculo para el desarrollo de medidas encaminadas a mitigar el cambio climático. Búscate un tratado, que tenga mucha letra y esté escrito en inglés. Propuesta de taxonomía europea, que pretende catalogar el gas y la nuclear bajo la etiqueta de energías verdes. El gas es un combustible fósil que debería dejar de utilizarse como tarde en 2035. No te quieres enterar, que tenemos también gas, gasoductos, petróleo y también fracking. Perforamos la tierra y los mares. Que siga el greenwashing, greenwashing, Que siga el greenwashing, Que no pare nunca, no pare, Que no pare el fósil,
La necesidad de salir del tratado de la Carta de la Energía para disminuir la capacidad de extorsión de la industria fósil y decir no a una herramienta de lavado verde como es la taxonomía europea. Queda claro que el tiempo se agota. Por ello, la acción climática debería colocarse como prioridad en el panorama político, social y mediático.
El documento se encuentra ahora en manos del Parlamento Europeo, quien tiene el poder de decir no al etiquetado del gas fósil y la energía nuclear como verde. No te quieres enterar, que tenemos la solar,
Que tenemos el viento y las mareas, que tenemos renovables espuertas y que despacito se vive mejor, con las amigas es muy disfrutón, comprando menos se vive mejor, dino al tratado, por favor.
Oh, you guys are very committed under the rain, but there were still quite a lot of people. It's a really nice campaign. We're about to finish this episode. It was great to finish on this. I want to ask you a little bit about your opinion, because you were saying that all this infrastructure that are being built is kind of a greenwashing. So that means that you don't actually believe that hydrogen is a suitable option to replace gas eventually. It won't work?
Not at all, because you cannot substitute fossil gas to green hydrogen 100%. So the hydrogen is needed for some small or hard abate sectors. So for example, for industry, chemical industry in some way, from the production of steel, for example, maybe if you, we cannot reduce everything about the planes or air travel or maritime travel, we can use a little bit of hydrogen for this, but you cannot just change an economy based in fossil fuels to an economy based in green hydrogen. Yeah, we need to reduce our energy consumption, but to use the hydrogen for the means that they, it's going to be. Yeah.
Yeah. So the point is that we need to change our economy in the way we produce simply because we are consuming too much energy. Okay, that's an interesting take, and I think it needs to be underlined. Maybe as a final closing question and statement, we've seen over the past 5 years now, because we're coming to the end of the current European Commission term, really strong commitments that have been taken in favor of developing renewable energy transition and the reduction of greenhouse gas emissions. Since we're now heading into an election period and there will be a new commission to be elected, which will hopefully design a Green Deal 2.0, I would like to ask you your perspective and what do you think are the most important areas that needs to be tackled and that they will have to be addressed by this new European Commission in its design of that Green Deal 2.0? Whoever wants to go first.
Marina, you can go first if you want.
Okay, I have to say that I don't believe that we have an ambitious plans now. We actually, from the civil society, are asking Europe to be decarbonized by 2040 instead of 2050, because we need to be aware that our debt in emissions. So Europe has been developed because of this. So for a climate justice reason, we need to degrow and we need to reduce our energy consumption and give the space for other countries to develop and to gain, you know, like a life in dignity. So this is like the main thing that we need to do, be more ambitious and establish good tools to do it. Don't let people like the fossil fuel industry to be making the rules that we need for decarbonize, because it has no sense, as the same example of the tobacco. So this will be like my the biggest statement.
Yeah, if I may compliment also from my view, is also that we need to ensure that the really this transition is fair, and it's fair and socially just, but globally, taking into account the global south, and it's more to take into account the role of Europe in the world, but also internally in Europe, and because there are many differences between the north of Europe, the south of Europe, the different regions in Europe, and so we need to really address these the inequalities and addressing the different needs. And also taking into account if the EU is expanding, and for example, some of the Balkans countries at the end are part of the EU. Also, we need to develop different mechanisms to really avoid the inequalities and the difference that there exists with these new countries that may enter the European Union. Oh, you're muted, Paul.
So the objective is ensuring a just transition and making sure that no one is left behind. Yeah, I think these are very smart words. I'm going to close the session right now. Thank you very much to both of you for participating. It was very enlightening. So I really appreciate you taking the time. And we'll be following the campaign that you are leading, Monica, and hoping that it will get to the point that we are expecting it to be. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Paul. Thank you for having us. Thank you for having the opportunity to share this moment with Marina as well. It was a pleasure. And I hope it was interesting for the participants.
Thank you
so much. Goodbye. Thanks.